Broadside Books and Harper Audio present Love Your Enemies, How Decent People Can Save America from the Culture of Contempt by Arthur C. Brooks. Read by Will Damron. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strained, it must not break our bonds of affection. The mystic cords of memory, stretching from every battlefield and patriot grave to every living heart and hearthstone all over this broad land, will yet swell the chorus of the Union when again touched, as surely they will be, by the better angels of our nature. Abraham Lincoln, First Inaugural Address. Introduction. Are you sick of fighting yet? I confess without shame, I am tired and sick of war. Its glory is all moonshine. General William Tecumseh Sherman, 1865. I live and work in Washington, D.C., but I'm not a politics junkie. To me, politics is like the weather. It changes a lot, people drone on about it constantly, and good is totally subjective. I like winter, you like summer. You're a liberal, I'm a conservative. Furthermore, political opinions are like noses. No two are totally alike, but everyone has one. My nose is big, but its existence is utterly unremarkable. Sort of like my political opinions. My thing is ideas, especially policy ideas. While politics is like the weather, ideas are like the climate. Climate has a big impact on the weather, but it's not the same thing. Similarly, ideas affect politics, but they aren't the same. When done right, policy analysis, like climate science, favors nerds with PhDs. And that's me. I have a PhD in policy analysis. For my doctorate, I studied applied microeconomics and mathematical modeling. I taught policy at a university for 10 years before becoming the president of a public policy think tank in Washington, D.C., a job I've held for a decade. Before graduate school, I spent 12 years making my living as a musician, but not the cool kind. I played the French horn in a symphony orchestra. So, yeah, nerdorama. Having a little distance from politics has made it so that even in the heart of D.C., I don't usually take political battles too seriously. In the 2012 presidential election season, my wife and I had a bumper sticker custom made for the Volvo, "Vegans for Romney," just to see the reaction of other D.C. drivers. However, even a climate scientist has to think about the weather when a hurricane comes ashore, and that's what's happening today. Political differences are ripping our country apart, rendering my big, fancy policy ideas largely superfluous. Political scientists find that our nation is more polarized than it has been at any time since the Civil War. This is especially true among partisan elites, leaders who, instead of bringing us together, depict our differences in unbridgeable, apocalyptic terms. As much as we'd like to, we can't joke the problem away. The only truly funny thing I've seen in our miserable political culture was a bumper sticker in the run-up to November 2016 that read, "Giant Meteor 2016," suggesting that a humanity-ending catastrophe would be better than the election's political choices. As my daughter would say, "That's dark, man." I remember when I first recognized the force of this hurricane, 2.5 years before the 2016 election. I was speaking to a large group of conservative activists in New Hampshire. Public speeches are a big part of what I do for a living, and I address audiences all across the political spectrum. It is the thing I most enjoy about my work. I love meeting people and sharing ideas. It never gets old. This particular audience was an ideological home field crowd for me, too, because the event was focused on the moral virtues of free enterprise. While I'm not a member of either political party, free enterprise is something I deeply believe in. I was the only non-politician on the schedule, and arriving a little early, I listened to a few of the other speakers before I went on. One after another told the audience that they were right and the opposing political side was wrong. By the time I went on stage, the crowd was pretty fired up. My speech was about how people naturally perceive conservatives and liberals in America today. I made the point that liberals are widely considered to be compassionate and empathetic, and that conservatives should work to earn this reputation as well. After the speech, a woman in the audience came up to me, and she was clearly none too happy with my comments. I thought she was going to criticize my assertion that conservatives are not thought to be as compassionate as liberals. Instead, she told me that I was being too nice to liberals. "They are not compassionate and empathetic," she said. "They are stupid and evil." She argued that as a public figure, I was obliged to say so plainly because it's the truth. At that moment, my thoughts went to Seattle. That's where I grew up. While my own politics tend more center-right, Seattle is arguably the most politically liberal place in the United States. My father was a college professor. My mother was an artist. Professors and artists in Seattle, what do you think their politics were? So when that woman in New Hampshire said that liberals are stupid and evil, she wasn't talking about me, but she was talking about my family. Without meaning to, she was effectively presenting me with a choice: my loved ones or my ideology. Either I admit that those with whom I disagree politically, including people I love, are stupid and evil, or I renounce my ideas and my credibility as a public figure. Love or ideology? Choose. Have you been subjected to a similar choice? Have you been told by a newspaper pundit, politician, college professor, or television host that your friends, family, and neighbors on the other side are knaves and fools, implying that if you have any integrity, you must stand up to them or leave them behind? That people with a different perspective hate our country and must be completely destroyed? That if you're not outraged, you're not paying attention? That kindness to your ideological foes is tantamount to weakness? Whether your politics are on the left, right, or center, most likely you have, and it might just be affecting your life. For example, a January 2017 Reuters Ipsos poll found that 1 in 6 Americans had stopped talking to a family member or close friend because of the 2016 election. A far bigger share of the population has sorted social life along ideological lines over the past few years by avoiding the places where people disagree with them, curating their news and social media to weed out opposing viewpoints, and seeking out the spaces, from college campuses to workplaces, where they find the most ideological compatriots. We are being driven apart, which is the last thing we need in what is a fragile moment for our country. America isn't in the midst of an economic collapse as we were in 2008, but we've faced major challenges in the past decade, economically, socially, and geopolitically. 10 years after the Great Recession, millions feel traumatized by political shifts, cultural change, and the uncertainties of a modern, globalized world. This is reflected in the deep pessimism felt throughout the country, even in the face of economic improvement. In a dramatically strengthening economy, more than 4 in 10 Americans say they think the nation's best years are behind us. Unemployment is the lowest it's been in decades, and yet 3/4 of Americans still say that either the middle class does not feel needed or useful in what they are doing and the work that they do, or the middle class feels value in what they are doing, but are not valued by the nation's elites and institutions. We need national healing every bit as much as economic growth. But what are we getting instead from many of our leaders in media, politics, entertainment, and academia? Across the political spectrum, people in positions of power and influence are setting us against one another. They tell us our neighbors who disagree with us politically are ruining our country. That ideological differences aren't a matter of differing opinions, but reflect moral turpitude. That our side must utterly vanquish the other, even if it leaves our neighbors without a voice. In the very moment in which America most needs to come together as a nation, in the early decades of what, for the good of the world, should be a new American century, we are being torn apart, thoughtlessly and needlessly. We are living in a culture of contempt. We need to fight back. But how? We were ready to fight. On September 16, 2017, Hawk Newsom and a group of protesters from Black Lives Matter of Greater New York arrived on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. to confront a group of Trump supporters gathered for what they called the mother of all rallies. A community activist from the South Bronx, Hawk had recently been on the front lines in Charlottesville, Virginia, protesting a rally by white nationalists that had made headlines all over the country. He was still nursing a wound from that confrontation, where he had been hit in the face with a rock. When Hawk and his team arrived on the mall, he braced for another confrontation and maybe more injuries. He figured the pro-Trump marchers were not much different from the white supremacists he had faced in Charlottesville. Hawk was filled with disdain for them. The protesters appeared to reciprocate his feelings, yelling, "USA! USA! You don't like it? Get out!" and "Ignore them! They don't exist!" The two sides traded insults, and the situation became more combustible by the second. Onlookers immediately pulled out their iPhones and became ersatz videographers, ready to capture the clash and post on social media. It was clear that yet another one of those ugly confrontations we have all come to dread was about to unfold. But then, just as the insults seemed ready to give way to blows, something wholly unexpected happened. Tommy Hodges, the organizer of the pro-Trump rally, invited Hawk Newsom onto his stage. "We're going to give you 2 minutes of our platform to put your message out," Tommy told Hawk. "Whether they disagree or agree with your message is irrelevant. It's the fact that you have the right to have the message." Hawk was ready to fight, not give a speech, but he accepted nonetheless. As he took the microphone in his hand, he thought back to a moment in Charlottesville when he was about to pick up a rock and throw it. This little old white lady, I don't know where she came from, but she said, "Your mouth is your most powerful weapon. You don't need anything but that." Now Hawk had a chance to use it. A committed Christian, he said a prayer, and as he did, he heard a voice in his heart telling him, "Let them know who you are." He took a deep breath and addressed the hostile crowd with passion and total sincerity. "My name is Hawk Newsom. I am the president of Black Lives Matter New York. I am an American." He had the crowd's attention, and he continued, "And the beauty of America is that when you see something broken in your country, you can mobilize to fix it," he said. To his utter surprise, the crowd burst into applause. Emboldened, he said, "So you ask why there's a Black Lives Matter? Because you can watch a black man die and be choked to death on television and nothing happened. We need to address that." "That was a criminal," someone yelled, as boos started emanating from the crowd. Hawk pressed on. "We're not anti-cop." "Yes, you are," someone yelled. "We're anti-bad cop," Hawk countered. "We say if a cop is bad, he needs to get fired like a bad plumber, like a bad lawyer, like a bad politician." At this, the crowd began cheering again. These days, there's nothing political ralliers hate more than bad politicians. "I said that I am an American. Secondly, I am a Christian," Hawk said, once again connecting with his audience. "We don't want handouts. We don't want anything that's yours. We want our God-given right to freedom, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." The crowd erupted in cheers. Then someone shouted, "All lives matter." "You're right, my brother. You're right. You are so right," Hawk said. "All lives matter, right? But when a black life is lost, we get no justice. That is why we say Black Lives Matter." His 2 minutes up, he concluded his remarks by saying, "Listen, I want to leave you with this, and I'm gone. If we really want to make America great, we do it together." The crowd roared. They started chanting, "USA! USA!" A lady standing in the front row reached up and handed Hawk an American flag. He held it up and waved it. More cheers. As he stepped off the stage, to his shock and amazement, many of the Trump supporters came up and embraced him. Earlier, when he first arrived on the mall, he had cut his hand with a knife while opening a box of signs. He had wrapped it in a bandana, but now it was bleeding through. The leader of a 4,000-man militia saw that Hawk was hurt and took him aside to treat his wound. He's treating my finger, Hawk says. And the militia guy goes, you know, I thought I understood before, but I get it now. You're all right, brother. We slapped hands. They have kept in touch since the rally. We're still friends on Facebook, Hawk says. Then a man named Kenny Johnson, one of the leaders of a group called Bikers for Trump, approached Hawk. He's like a Sons of Anarchy type, Hawk recalls. He said, your speech was amazing. I'd be honored if you met my son. So we walked over to see his son, who was playing with his toys under a tree, a little blonde-haired kid named Jacob. Johnson asked Hawk to pick the boy up so they could take a picture together. That touched me, Hawk says. After meeting Hawk, Johnson told Vice News, I feel what he said came from his heart when he got on the stage. I probably agree with 90% of what he said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.